Hello. As you can see, I have left capitalist Western countries behind me and have returned to glorious Eastern Europe. And here I'm going to draw for you. But first of all, take a look at these beautiful motion picture images. I am sure these will help convince you of the superiority of Eastern Europe. What I want to draw today is probably the best vehicle ever built in glorious Soviet Union. It is the Dacia 1300. Alright, let me stop with this silly accent. I know it's horrible, but it's so much fun I could do it throughout the whole video. Since most of you lovely people already know my workflow, I'm just going to do a quick run through of how I approach a drawing like this, and then I'm going to tell you fun little facts about the Dacia, based on some of the recollections of my dad, who had the pleasure of fully enjoying communism and driving a Dacia in those glorious days. As always, I start the drawing with a rough sketch where I don't worry about detail because I want to get the proportions right. Even though here, if I look at the end result, the greenhouse became a bit small. For this, I use my favorite sketching brush from Kevin Mellon's brush set. This base sketch I tend to build within a geometric shape so I can easier measure and compare proportions. The lines I use are nice and thick, forcing me not to pay much attention to detail. I make sure to use the digital tools that I have at hand, and I use the lasso tool, select, resize and move parts around of my sketch if it is necessary. After I'm done with the basic sketches, I lower the opacity of the layer I was working on and I create a new layer. On this one, I switch to the Hudson Rio Design line work pencil and start redrawing the image based on the underlying sketch. I tend to end up with fairly clean line work, so I like to keep some of the lines a bit more loose to not make the drawing too rigid. If I need to draw over lines, I usually draw on a new layer and only erase the lines below once I'm sure about the new element. This way the drawing remains much cleaner. And from here on, just follow the base sketch lines and rinse and repeat. Okay, now about the interesting stuff. The Dacia 1300. This was Romania's main workhorse car and I would say a fairly good representation of Eastern Europe in general. It was peak communism in Romania, and the glorious leaders in the party decided they want the people of Romania to have their own official car. And because communism was such a great system, they were not dumb to design it themselves. Oh no no no, my friend. They were going to let those silly Western capitalists come up with a design and they'll just buy it off of them. So the glorious leaders, after shopping around among several Western car manufacturers, ended up with Renault. The deal was to license the Renault 12 model and produce it in Romania as the Dacia 1300. Fun fact about the Renault 12 model, she was a bit of a flirt, that one, wasn't she? The French licensed it all over the world, not just Romania. It was built in Turkey, Australia, New Zealand and even the Americas, especially Latin America, Brazil, Colombia, Argentina. Anyways, the Renault 12 was not ready for a whole year when Romania made the deal. So in the meantime, they licensed the Renault 8 model, which was a bridging car until they could license the next one, and they called this one the Dacia 1100. But yeah, as I said, we are concentrating on the Dacia 1300, which started manufacturing in 1969. Let me preface this by saying that everything I'm telling you here is what I heard from my old man. So it's a personal experience, and that may vary from person to person, so take it with a pinch of salt. But back in those days, cars weren't common at all over here. This wasn't capitalist decadent United States, after all. My city back then had around maybe 30 personal cars and a maximum of 10 taxis, something like that. In good old glorious communism, you couldn't just go out and buy a car willy-nilly. Oh, no, no. You had to sign up for one, pay a deposit for it and wait around a whole year until you got it. That is, if you were enlightened enough to join the party. If you were one of them dissident troublemaking kind who didn't join the party yet, well, your name on that waiting list could drop and you might have to wait several extra months. Also, some colors had a higher manufacturing rate, so people who wanted the Ferrari red would have to wait for a long time. If, however, you were an upstanding party member and also paid off an acquaintance at the factory to slide your name a bit higher on that waiting list, you had a brand spanking new Dacia 1300. A slight hiccup was the fact that you couldn't necessarily get the car in the same state you were living in. it might be that you had to travel 2 states to a local storage area, which hopefully wasn't too far from where you were living, because the infallible communist leadership has decided you only got to have 20 liters of gasoline a month. Obviously, the industrious communist citizen had to get some more fuel than that by appropriating it from example from those pesky fire engines. It's not like they needed that much. You just hook up the wiring of the mileage to a drill, give it the rotations it needs for a couple of hours, and liberate it from the corresponding amount of gasoline. If you don't have the connections at the fire department, you can just try and mix the gasoline with some diesel, so you have more of it. Sure, why not? Obviously, we could not let our precious leaders and intellectual masterminds occupying high positions in the party be constricted by 20 liters of gasoline. No, they, of course, had access to unlimited gasoline and free servicing. And speaking of servicing, the toolkit you got with every car was a screwdriver, 3 different wrenches, a hammer, 2 pliers, and a crank. The car was so simple that this set of tools pretty much got you covered for most roadside troubles you might encounter. It is important to say that while the base Renault model was a relatively good and reliable car, after the first line was assembled, Romania started switching to local manufacturers and suppliers, which during the height of communist glory were, according to Western capitalist propaganda, inferior products. So you had many Dacia 1300s with added wooden parts, corroded holes in them, and all sorts of knickknacks running around the streets. Speaking of Romania's streets, they were somewhat different. The proud communist working spirit did not allow for boasting with things like highways. The modest worker will be more than content with regular roads, even if the country is only barely smaller than Germany. And to keep the citizen on his or her toes, roads were designed with potholes in them so that if you manage to avoid 2, you will for sure hit the 3rd one. This way, no one really had to worry about cars speeding. I remember once driving down a hill, my dad actually almost hit 140 kilometers an hour, and I was holding on to the door because I heard a lot of rattling and I was afraid it would fall off. I must say, I had some good memories with that car. Wait, actually, scratch that. I always got car sick in that because the stench of the gasoline always came through the tank. And it was hot during summer and cold during winter. The communist citizen did not need decadent luxuries like heating or air conditioning. If it was too warm, open the windows. If it was too cold, you could send some of that engine-heated air into the passenger compartment, which then naturally would escape through the badly isolated doors. So yeah. That was the Dacia 1300, and despite my tone, the car was very successful and was in use for a long time. Right now, the modern versions of the Dacia are some of the cheapest and most versatile people's cars in Europe. I hope you enjoyed this little anecdote about communist vehicular transportation. If you have any questions or suggestions for future videos, please leave me a comment. Also, consider subscribing if you like this sort of content and would love to see more. You can also follow me on Instagram for a whole bunch of more sketching-related posts. Hope you have a great week and see you folks next time. Bye-bye!